Cloud. Yes, it is recording now. Okay, thank you. Then I'll share my screen once more time. Okay. There are so many different ways of defining the concept of stability. There are also many ways of looking at the stability. In the classical systems, what I mean with classical systems is we are dealing with the input and also output of the system. Whereas if the systems are more complicated, if you are dealing with more than one variable to control, I don't know, if you are controlling the temperature of a reactor together with its pressure, for example, things may change because those variables may affect each other. You have to take care of these influences into consideration. You have to develop or design a controller that can deal with, you know, managing these more than one variables. Those multivariable systems, nonlinear systems, in those cases, the definition of stability is different because you are now, you need to now study the analysis of maybe each so-called state. Even the inner variables have to be observed, have to be analyzed in terms of stability. Some people call it inner stability for those methods. They are using, or we are using, Lyapunov-based methods, which are based on the energy of, for example, a spring, because we know that the energy goes to zero over time. So you are trying to establish a kind of equation representing the stability of that system, showing that the transients die out over time. As I said, there are these kinds of methods, but since we are dealing with CISO systems, single input, single output systems, we need to first, well, this is the starting point anyway, we need to first be familiar with the stability of single input, single output systems. So, as we said, we need to first of all make sure that the system is stable. Otherwise, we are unable to work with other parameters, including transient and steady state parameters. So we are concentrating on linear time invariant systems. In the first approach of stability definition for single input, single output systems, even multiple input, multiple output systems, as long as the system is linear time invariant, what is linearity? Linearity, as you may even guess from the name, the input-output relationship, the input-output relationship can be, you know, represented with a linear curve starting from zero. Well, this is a kind of linear system, but there is a delay involved, so you have to take care of this delay. What does that mean? This is the delay, TD, because you are introducing your inputs, okay, but you are getting no outputs. up to this point, up to TD, time delay. So for example, this is a main issue, especially in process control systems. Suppose that you are doing temperature control and the fuel is coming from a distance. You start your control, okay, you energize your control system, but since there's a distance for the fuel to flow and come to the boiler to start the ignition, well, it takes time, so you have to deal with this time delays as well. Anyway, it is called at least piecewise linear. There are some typical non-linearities. In fact, you should be aware of. Maybe I should talk about them in an empty because we can be easily finish this chapter. The main concern should be learning those concepts. There's vertigo. Insert new slides. Okay, so we are talking about linear time invariant systems. Linear time invariant systems, as the name suggests, if this is input and xi, and if this is output, oh, let me use another letter, y. Okay. Suppose that this is y, and to emphasize that it is output y, yo, why not? So first of all, the relationship between them must be linear. Okay. And this linearity is measured with homogeneity and superposition. Superposition. Homogeneity and superposition. So if the input is x1 and the output is y1, my writing is so bad today. I'll try to be better. If you introduce alpha times or alpha fold of input, okay, you need to get the alpha fold of alpha times of the output. This is called homogeneity. And superposition, if in one instance you got when you introduced x1, you got y1, and in another instance when you introduced x2, you get y2. And if you sum or if you apply another input which is just sum of those previous ones, will cause the output of y1 plus y2. So if this superposition and homogeneity analysis are done, if they are provided, that means the system is stable. How about the sources of instability? There are many. Instability. No, not instability. Non-linearity. Excuse me. Non-linearity. Sources of. I think I should go to. You name it. The OneNote. This draw. I didn't like this. Anyway. I'll use this. Okay, non-linearity. Non-linearities. Let me tell you that there are so many reasons for non-linearities, but one of the most frequently encountered ones is actuator saturation. Okay. Actuator saturation. Suppose that you are controlling a motor or driving a motor through an op amp. Okay, so op amp provides control input to the motor to rotate. But okay, we know that the input output relationship is just linear, but we know that after some values of input, there is almost no output. Okay, this saturation can be seen in op amps, can be seen in some sensors, for example, temperature sensors. You may get a very high quality sensor, and there is a very linear relationship. If there's a very relationship, linear relationship between the input and output, all right. But after some degrees to measure, although the temperature rises, there is no output, you know, representing this input. So this saturation phenomena, let's say, occur a lot. So we have to make sure that we are working at least within this linear region. So this is called saturation, non-linearity due to saturation. Another one, since we are using motors and gearboxes, okay, so gears, if they are not tight well, if they are not coupling in a, if they are not very nicely aligned, and if they are not coupled, there is another phenomenon called backlash. And if I say something you would love, this backlash is important also in the automotive industry, in the gearboxes of automobiles. So in those routine, you know, car services, they do backlash adjustment. Okay, so there is a tolerable amount of backlash. So they are tightening those coupled gears so that they when the driving gear rotates just a little bit, the output gear has to also rotate, not after some time, because there is a kind of if there's a backlash between those coupling or coupled gears, this phenomenon occurs. I'm sure you are familiar with this. The funny thing is, if you go to sanayi, otosanayi in Turkish, they translated this backlash, the word, as bektaş ayarı. Çünkü the word is they sound well. They are saying, so it is now a kind of Turkish word. They say, abi bektaş ayarı yapalım mı? So he means, or mostly he, of course, the guys working in the industry, otosanayi, they say bektaş. They mean backlash is this. Suppose that the input output relationship is quite good between the gears, input gear and output gear, okay, no problem. But when you change the direction, okay, I mean, when you increase the input, the output is also increased, no problem. And the relationship is quite linear. But if you do just the other way around, if you decrease the input after some point, okay, in this case, suppose that you are reversing the car, okay? But in reverse, it follows another path, okay? This is called saturation due to backlash. And this is this phenomenon actually is occurred in electromagnetism as well, electromagnetism. especially in transformers. What are they called? Hysteresis. Hysteresis. Yes. Hysteresis. So it is a the way that those primary and secondary windings are get magnetized is different when you increase the electromagnetism and when you decrease the electromagnetism. They may follow. It is. I once, you know, in my life gave that electric machine courses at Bilgi University. It was like this. So this is the, when you go, when you increase input, the output is also increased, sort of linear, but when you do the decrease, it goes like this, okay? Very nice looking picture. The figure is very nice, the picture is very nice, but unfortunately the phenomenon is not something expected. So saturation is problem they have to be dealt with, and backlash is another problem. What else? Saturation, backlash. I think there's one more to see. Well, I can remember later on. Okay, let us carry on. Let us carry on. So let us see the. So we are. And one more thing. Linear time. I said linear. Okay, linearity is this. Time invariance is. I can give you the mathematical description for that. But time invariance, if you are representing a system with differential equations, since you are dealing with dynamic systems, you are working with differential equations. If the coefficients, because time invariant is a strange concept. What is time invariant? Time is variant. Time varies, you know, all the time, of course. But although time varies, your components, let's say, the values of your components, like mass, like coefficient of viscous friction, spring constant, your resistor, your inductor, capacitor, what else? The weight. If we are assuming that they are just staying as they are, constant. They don't change over time. That's why we say linear and time invariant systems. Unfortunately, this world is such a world that everything is changing, including we people. You know, if you look at even your pictures daily, you see that you are changing. You are changing. Everything is changing. But if that change is in an acceptable level, you say that this is a linear time invariant system. Let us design a controller for this linear LTI system. Okay, that's I think enough for the, let's say, general culture. So we are going to talk about stability, instability, and there is another concept: marginal stability. Marginal. Well, the words are quite clear. Stable is stable. Look at this definition. A linear time invariant system, an LTI system, is stable, okay, if the natural response approaches zero as time approaches infinity. We know that the total, okay, I'll go later on. This is one. Unstable is, an LTI system is unstable if the natural response grows, okay, without bound as time approaches infinity, okay. And marginal stable is, a linear time invariant system is marginal stable if the natural response neither decays nor grows, but remains constant, but particularly oscillates as time approaches infinity. I'm sure you would immediately remember those kinds of outputs produced by second order or higher order systems. For example, an undamped system. What is undamped system? It keeps oscillating. So it is a typical marginally stable system. It typically represents a marginally stable system. An overdamped system, quite stable. An underdamped system, quite stable. Critically damped stable. Critically damped system, it is stable. But undamped, okay, systems are marginally stable. Okay, marginally stable. So you are looking at, okay, you are looking at I don't know how many stated, the total response, total output or the response consists of two main components. One of them is transient, the other one is forced or steady state. Okay, so the stability, if a system to be stable, the definition is this. This transient part or natural part, let us use this word natural because we should follow the textbook. Okay. If this natural part goes to zero as time approaches infinity, the system is stable. Okay. If, I mean, as time approaches infinity, if this natural part, okay, if this natural part grows unboundedly, okay, this system is unstable, and if, as again, when time goes to infinity, if the natural part keeps oscillating, let's say, the system is marginally stable. Margin means, lower and upper limits of something, right? It oscillates within or between the margins. Okay, they don't just blow up. Okay, they don't diminish, but they just, oscillating. If they are just oscillating, that means they are marginally stable. If you think of those marginal people, they are in between two very excessive feelings, they never in between those marginal people. That's the case, in fact. Okay, another definition again for linear time invariant systems. You should at least know this word, BIBO, bounded input, bounded output. It says the system is either stable or unstable. What is marginally stable? It is not something useful. So we shouldn't even call it stable, okay? This definition says a system is stable if every bounded input yields a bounded output. This system is BIBO stable, okay? A system is stable if every bounded input yields a bounded output. On the other hand, a system is unstable if you can see that, or if you can show that any bounded input causing an unbounded output, That means you are proving that the system is unstable. Okay, now let us check the stability of the systems, linear time invariant systems, by looking at the characteristics equation. Excuse me. If you could give me a couple of minutes, let me save this, let me save this to another location. Okay, documents versus the, okay, system dynamics and control as PDF. Okay, export. Okay, I don't. Let me save. Okay, I'll start OneNote. Okay, OneNote, great. And when we are talking about, let me save time. When we are talking about stability, we are talking about output stability. And output is output of what? Output of the closed loop system. Output of the closed loop system. So add a new section, insert, I guess, maybe print out. Go to EEEEM52 and find this document, chapter 6. You are seeing all my files, which is not so good. It starts with chapter 6. Okay, that's it. All right, so this is more stable. This program is more stable. Okay, good. If the closed loop system, so we are looking at the closed loop system, and also maybe I mentioned before, okay, for stability analysis, okay, where were we? Okay, here we go. Yeah, this is an important slide. We know that our transfer functions, okay, suppose that we have an open loop transfer function. Okay, let me quickly scribble here. Oh, when I say command Z, it goes to the end. This is silly. Oh my God. So I won't use that command Z. Undo. Okay. 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 So we need to deal with suppose that this is your typical feedback system. Okay, I don't know why I am going up. Anyway, let's see. Let's suppose that it is like this. Okay. As you know, this is negative feedback. We keep comparing the set point, the input with the output, okay. And we are suppose that we are in the S domain. This is, if this is G of S, if this is H of S, the open loop transfer function is just, or in some books it says loop transfer function is this, G times G of S times H of S, okay? And in many cases, the poles are seen. The poles are easily detectable. But the closed loop transfer function, as you know, it is the forward path transfer function over 1 plus the, we proved this a couple of weeks ago, okay, 1 over G of S, H of S. This denominator, okay, this denominator is called, if this is denominator, right? This denominator is called characteristic equation. Characteristic equation. Why characteristic? This is a very nice, actually, specification. We are specifying because it specifies, it characterizes the system. If it is stable, if it is unstable, if it is marginally stable, if it is fast, if it is slow, if it does oscillations, everything. So important. So the denominator of the closed loop system is called characteristic equation. So we need to find, or we need to study the roots of, okay, the roots of this characteristic equation. What are they called? What do we call the roots of denominator? They are simply poles of, okay, poles of closed loop transfer function. Okay, closed loop transfer function. So the poles of closed loop transfer function, or the roots of denominator of the closed loop transfer function, have to be analyzed, because if all simply we say closed loop transfer functions with poles, if they are only in the left half of the S plane, okay, if they are all, okay, if, suppose that, if they are, suppose that we are analyzing the poles, suppose that if they are all in the left, okay, they are stable, but these are not open loop poles, they are closed loop poles, okay? So we have to make sure that they are only in the left half plane. If at least one, closed loop transfer functions with at least one pole in the right half plane, and or poles of multiplicity greater than one on the imaginary axis. What does that mean? We can show mathematically, maybe later on. If there is at least one simple pole, little bit in the right half plane, if more than one pair, more than one imaginary pole pair, if more than one imaginary pole pairs are on the imaginary axis, it is unstable. Okay, so this part is unstable. This border between the stable region and unstable region is this border. What is this border? This is the J omega axis. This is the real axis, right? This is the J omega or imaginary axis. This imaginary axis is the border between the stable and unstable regions. And if you are, we will see this, if there is only one pair on the imaginary axis and the next or the rest of the poles are, I don't know, either real or complex conjugate in the left half plane, they can be stable, at least marginally stable, okay? And marginal stable closed loop transfer functions with only imaginary axis poles of multiplicity one, not more, and the poles in the left half plane, okay? So how can we know that? There are ways of doing knowing this, okay? Suppose that this d of s, the how do you say, the denominator or characteristic equation, okay? It let it be a fourth order system. I don't know, 8 s to power of 4 plus 3 s to power of 3 plus 5 s square, okay, plus 2s plus 10. Okay, suppose that this is the characteristic equation. Is this stable or not? We don't know. How can we know? Okay, you may say that, come on, we have nice tools, including MATLAB. You just enter this, okay, as just so easy. You just say roots, okay, in an array, okay, of these coefficients, 8, 3, 5, 2, 10. And then just enter and see if there is any negative pole. Sorry, negative poles are good. If there is any positive pole, if there is at least one positive pole, which means if there is a pole, which is the root of denominator in the right half plane, you can say that, oh, okay, this is unstable. Why do we need this analysis tool, which is coming, called Rouse-Hurwitz? But it is important because these roots can be a function of a variable, namely gain. You will see. For example, look at this. Two cases, okay, one, two. I know these figures are too small. I'll show the nicer ones. Okay. Look at this. What happened to this? Okay, I can show you. Suppose that we have a simple third order system, okay? G of S, okay? This is G of S, okay. G of S is 3 over, okay, S times S plus 1, S plus, what is it? 2, okay. What are the, where are the poles, open loop poles? Okay, let us emphasize it. Open loop poles are so easy. One of them is at 0, at minus 1, at minus 2. Are they stable? Yes, they are stable. There's only one at the origin. And this is in the left. This is in the left half plane. Okay. So this is, it is stable. But how about then? Because in the end, what matters is the closed loop systems behavior. Bozuk systems dynamics. Okay, so you need to find the closed loop transfer function, which is just g of s over 1 plus g of s, because it is a unity feedback, no HS. And you see that it can be easily found as s square, s cube, okay, plus 2s, 3s, 3s square, plus 2s, all right? Yes, that's it, plus 2s, plus 3 comes, okay. So if this is just k, a k comes, okay? So you now tell me if this system is stable. Okay, you just, here it is. I can switch on MATLAB, no problem. But here, if you enter the numerator, if you enter the denominator, which is the convolution of s, s plus 1, s plus 2, if you get this transfer function, and then if you just, sort of interrogate the pose, you need to find, this is the automatic way of finding the closed loop transfer function, g of s over 1 plus g of s. This feedback command does this for you. Okay, if you check the pose, or you can use the command of roots of denominator. Okay, look at these poles. One of them is just minus 2.67. The other two are complex conjugate, minus 0.164, plus and minus 1i or 1j. Look at here. One of them is here, okay? The other two are complex conjugate and here. Are they all in the left half plane? Yes. And if you check the output, you can simulate it easily. You just use step. Now you are quite familiar with MATLAB commands, okay? If you do just step T, you get this, okay? Is this an acceptable response? Is it stable? Yes, it is stable. Because as time goes to infinity, right? The transients die out, right? The transients go to zero. Just remaining part is the steady state part. So the system is stable. How do we know that it is stable? Because we checked the roots. Look at this, exactly the same system. Now, the numerator is 7. K is now 7 instead of 3. You do the same computation, okay? And now you have T of S equals 7 over S cube plus, what was it? S cube plus 3s square. Plus 2s plus 7. If you check the roots of this polynomial, in other words, the system poles, closed loop systems poles, you see that the pole, one of the pole is good. It's doing quite well, because in the left half plane, minus 3. And the other two are, look at where they are. The real part is just 0.04. It is not to scale, as the book warns us. It is little bit, in fact, it is around here, okay? And no problem with the imaginary parts. Look at the response. If you go even further, these oscillations, oh my God, they will grow and grow and grow, and it'll blow up, you know? No system can bear with this. So this system is unstable. We just changed one single parameter, which is the gain. So we have to analyze. We have to know that we are working in the stable region. We cannot increase the gain as much as we want. Oh, this system responds too slowly. Let us increase the gain. You cannot do that because you have to make sure that you are within the stable region. Okay, how can we check this stability? This is a bit old, but still not obsolete. They are still in use. Rouse-Hurwitz criterion. I'm sure my dear professor know those Hurwitz equations. They are big mathematicians, but they offered, they put a very nice criterion that tells us just by looking at the coefficients of the denominator or characteristic equation, let's say, and it checks, it doesn't tell us the locations of the exact locations of the poles, okay, but the method tells us, say that it is fifth order, hey, three of them are in the left half plane, two of them are in the right half plane. The method tells us this. So if at least one of them is in the right half plane, that means the system is unstable, even if it is a little bit in the right. Why? Because you know this even before, even from Laplace transform table. Suppose that the closed loop system transfer function is something like this, okay? S plus 2, S plus 5, I don't know, and one single S minus tiny pole, okay? We know that if you do the inverse Laplace transform to get the output, you need to do, you name it, partial fraction expansion, okay? And then we get A1. Hello? You got those residues, A exponential minus 2t, right? Plus a residue exponential minus 5t. Plus exponential plus 0.2t. Look, this is, if you look at each of them, it goes, I want to change, fed up with this color. Anyway, this color is good. Okay, depending on this value, it for example, this is if this is exponential 2t, it starts from here. Exponential 5t, the case goes to zero more quickly. Okay, but this term maybe slow, but it grows, you know, unboundedly, let's say, I can say, over as time goes to infinity. So these, the effects of both of them, although they look more dominant, but they end within some seconds. But the remaining part takes the output to infinity. So even this one tiny little pole in the right half plane makes the system dangerous, unstable. Okay, so using this method, we can tell how many closed loop system poles are in the left half plane, in the right half plane, and on the j omega axis. Notice that we say how many, not where. So it doesn't tell us the exact location, but it tells the number of poles in the left, number of poles in the right, and number of poles on the j omega axis. Okay, so but before that there are some simple tests. Okay, now we will see that Rawls suggested us doing this table and computing, and Rawls and Hurwitz together they proposed this nice method. But before this method, we can do some simple checks even with inspection, right? I don't know how to prove mathematically, but suppose that you have this fourth order system. And another fourth order system. I'm just making up examples, okay? Now let's check them. First, we are checking the powers. Okay? We are writing in a descending order, okay? And we are checking the powers of S. 4, 2, where is cube? 4, 2. So there is no need to check. This is unstable. If you check the roots of this polynomial, I'm 100% sure that one of the poles, at least one of the poles, is positive in the right half plane. So it is unstable. Look at here. 4, 3, 2, 1, and this is s to the power of 0. 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. All the powers exist, okay, no problem. But one of the coefficients of S is negative. This is certainly unstable, okay? No need to analyze, no need to go and use Rawls-Hurwitz criterion, no need to use MATLAB, no need to, plot the output, simulate the system, no need. It is unstable, okay? Because one of the coefficients have a different sign, okay? Look at this, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0, plus, 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 plus. Okay, this could be stable, maybe unstable, we don't know. We have to analyze it. How about the last one, this? I'll write the same one. Is this stable or unstable? We don't know, because you can factor this minus one out, okay? You get the same as this, okay? And you can say that, okay, this is, if this is a gain parameter, it is a negative gain, it is okay. It just changes the direction of the motion, okay? It is nothing to do with the stability, okay? This is, if they are all negative, so it could be exactly like this. It could be stable or unstable. It needs to be checked. It needs to be analyzed. Okay, so far so good. We are doing, is there any question? We are using this Rawls-Hurwitz criterion, Rawls-Hurwitz stability criterion to check especially the higher order systems stability that in just one look or inspection, we cannot decide if they are stable or unstable. If the poles are, if the gain is already selected, if they are not anymore they are not depending on the value of gain, but they can still, you can change the gain. You can use those tools to find the roots or poles of the system. But suppose that you don't have those tools. Let us use simple math. Okay. So this is the output is C of S, R of S. So this is the closed loop transfer function or closed loop system. Okay. Closed loop systems transfer function. Okay. This is numerator, N of S. Numerator doesn't affect the stability. Even those, what is the roots of numerator? They are called zeros, okay? Zeros can be in the left, in the right, no problem. Well, they are problematic if at least one of them in the right, they causes that non-minimum phase effect. I little bit talked about it, if you remember. You are commanding the motor to rotate clockwise, but it first rotates counterclockwise, and then after some time it reaches at your direction, your commanded direction, and rotates in that direction. Okay, it is not a good effect, but it is stable. Okay, so, and zeros, the the magnitude of zeros affect the magnitude of the output, but it doesn't have any effect on the stability. So what are we gonna check? We are gonna check the poles. Poles are obtained from the characteristic equation. So characteristic equation's roots are poles, and they need to be checked. So this is a table. This is called the label column. Okay, the first column is label column. Of course, these are rows. Okay, these are rows. All right. So in the first row, you just let me enlarge this. Okay. You just write the first coefficients. A4 is coefficient of S4. Okay. Then here in this next line row, coefficient of S cube. Then coefficient of S square. Then coefficient of S. Well, you can say that we are, this is the highest power of S. You write here the highest power of S, this coefficient. And then skip one, okay? And then you write here the rest of them, okay? And then we'll see how to fill in these elements, okay, these cells. Here it is. Minus determinant, okay, this, you take A4, A3 in the first column, and A2, A1, okay, in the second column, divided by one above, A3, okay, but the determinant is negative. In other words, you know how to find determinants. Multiply A4, by A1, and subtract from the multiplication of A2, A3, and then take this negative. But instead, I do this. A3 times A2, okay, minus A4 times A1, okay? Divided by, again, the same A3, okay? And you do the same. Again, the first column never changes, okay? A4, A3. And the we use this column. Now it is time to use the next one, A0. So we are here, A0, 0. A0, 0. you compute this element B2 in the same way, the negative determinant, okay? And the last one is now, the first column is the same. The first column, the same, the same, the same. And the second column, we use this first, and then this, and then now there is nothing left, so use 0, 0. Because there is nothing here, there is none here. Okay, 0, 0. You go on the same fashion. It is not complicated. Since we are working with those letters instead of numerical values, it looks complicated. No, not at all. Look at here. Look at here. Make the this simple example. Make the Rouse table for the system given. This is the system. Unfortunately, look at this. The open loop poles are easy. -2, -3, -5. No problem. But you need to find the closed loop transfer function and concentrate on the denominator. S cube plus 10 S square plus 31 S plus it from here. I think it comes 5 times 3, 15 by 2, 30 plus 1,000, 1,030. It comes from there. So this is the polynomial. Can you tell me just by looking at the denominator, where the poles are? Not easy. You can still find by hand. How about if it was fourth order? So let us use this Rouse-Hurwitz criterion. All we need to do is write the label column starting from the maximum power of S, which is S square. So S cube, S square, S to the power of zero, nothing. Okay, then the coefficient of S cube is one. Skip this because it is even power. Well, if this starts with an odd power, you just write here odd ones, okay? 1, 31, and none, nothing. Then the leftover ones, 10, 1,030, okay? 1,030. You can do row-wise simplification, since this is 10, 1,030. You just multiply each element by 1 over 10 so that get rid of this 0. It becomes just 1. Becomes just 103. Okay. And then carry on. This is the determinant. These first two rows are directly written from the polynomial. And the rest will be computed with simple math. Okay, so 1, 1, the first column is 1, 1, and second column is next to each, next to this, 31, 103, 31, 103. But we know that negative determinant divided by the one, just above one. Okay, so instead of doing this multiplication, minus this, then minus, I just do this, multiply this, 31 minus 103 makes minus 72 divided by 1 minus 72, okay? So this is 1, 1, 0, 0, it is just 0. So minus 32, and this will be, just go and take two of them, two elements, from above, 1, 1 minus 72, and write next column as this, 103, 0, 103, 0, 0. And then do this simple computation, 0, okay, plus 0, so there is none comes, 72 times 103 divided by 72, just 103, you know, remains. And the next is zero, zero. This is the, how do, we will do an example by hand, no problem. So this is, you name it, how we create the Rouse table. Then the analyze, the analysis stage starts. The analysis stage is so simple. You're gonna just check this first column. The first column, in fact, is the first column is called label column or labeling column, whatever you name it. But this is the first column, in fact, because you are doing the computations in this, starting from this column. You are just checking the signs of the elements. If there is no change in the signs, you say that all the poles are in the left half plane. So the system is 100%, okay, stable. I don't like to say 100%. That I had a guest last week from Dubai. Oh my God. In every 2 minutes, you know, 100%. Oh, it is, yes, 100%, 100%. So it is stable. If it is stable, that means it is 100% stable. In fact, as a matter of fact, there is a degree of stability, okay? But this is some other issue I won't cover. Okay, skip that. Now let's see how to interpret the Rouse table, okay? The Rouse service criterion declares that the number of roots of the polynomial that are in the right half plane is equal to the number of sign changes in the first column. So simple. Number of sign changes gives us the number of right half plane, okay? And we know that if the closed loop transfer function has all poles in the left half of the S-plane, the system is stable. So a system is stable if there are no sign changes in the first column. So let's see, let's check this example. Do you think this is a stable or not stable system? Let us write here the first column. It was 1, 1 minus 72, 103. Okay. Look at now. Okay. Look at now. This is plus, plus, and from plus to minus, from minus to another plus. So one change here, the other change here. That means number of, okay, number of sign changes, number of sign changes is 2. That means number of right half plane poles is 2. Is the system stable or unstable? It is unstable. It is unstable. Okay. So this is the way we are checking the system's stability. Okay. Any questions so far? How are we doing? Shall we take a break? How do you feel? You are okay? I feel good when I'm with you guys, huh? Seriously, I'm okay. Let us carry on another 15 minutes, okay? Let us take a break at or by 11, okay? There is no action, so that means everybody's happy. If you are happy, I am more than happy. When we analyze this first column, okay, we may, at once there are three messages complaining. No problem, no complaint. Instable, yes, it is instable. Good, thank you, okay. I'll put it here. So when we inspect this first column, okay, we may across two special cases. What are they? The first case is this. There could be a zero, okay, a zero only the first column of a row. We have a zero only. But there could be one zero in the first column. If it is zero, zero is, you know, is it positive or negative? So we cannot conclude, our methods. So what can we do if there is a zero in the first column? Second special case is if the whole row is full of zeros. Okay, this indicates something else, something quite interesting. I'll come to this. Okay, now special case number one, zero only in the first column. Go to the example. Okay, suppose that this is the closed loop, okay, closed loop transfer function. 10 over s to the power of 5, 2 s to the power of 4, 3 s cubed, 6 s squared, 5 s plus 3. Okay, this is the closed loop transfer function. Okay, as I said, come on, hocam, I can check the poles easily in MATLAB. Okay, you can do that. Go and do that. But you will see that these poles can be a function of k. In that case, you need this method, and you need to, as I said, determine the range of gain for stability. Okay. So this is starts from one. You can make one easily. If, for example, if this is two, divide numerator and denominator by two. You can make one. You don't have to, but it is not unusual to see the maximum power of s starting with one. I mean, with no coefficient means one. So first, label column starting from the maximum power s to power of 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Okay, so what is the coefficient of this maximum power of s? 1. And then skip 1. Since this is odd, take the odd coefficients, odd powers coefficients. 1, 1, 3, 5. 1, 3, 5. If it, another one is needed, 0. Okay. And the remaining ones, the even ones, 2, 6. What is this? Okay. 2, 6, and 3. Okay. 1, 3, 5, 2, 6, 3. Then this, do this multiple, 2 by 3, 6, minus 6, okay, 0. Divided by 2, 0. So it is 0. And this, 2 times 5, 10, minus 3 times 1, 10 minus 3, 7, divided by 2. So 7 over 2. 3.5, okay, and remainings are 0, 0, 2 by 0 is 0, 0 by 1 is 0, divided by 2 is 0, okay. So you see there is a 0, special case number 1. What to do? Just insert here a small number called epsilon. Okay, epsilon. Epsilon, and carry on your computation. So the next element, 6 times epsilon, okay, minus 7, because 7 over 2 by 2 is 7. Okay, 6 epsilon minus 7 divided by epsilon. Okay, and then this 6, excuse me, epsilon, 3 epsilon, okay, minus 0 over epsilon. 3 epsilon over epsilon makes 3. Okay, and then a bit complicated because there's a polynomial here, a fractional number. 6 epsilon minus 7 over epsilon times 3.5 minus 3 epsilon divided by the whole bunch of these, you know, numbers, you get this, okay? 42 epsilon minus 49 minus 6 epsilon square divided by 12 epsilon minus 14. And then this, if this is x, 0 by x is 0, minus 0 by epsilon is 0, divided by this, 0, and 0. And this is, just take this to here, 3. Why? Because nothing comes from here. This complicated equation by this, divided by these complicated ones, just 3 comes. Okay, now it is time to study this first column, column 1, or first column. Okay, first column. Let me carry this first column here. What do we have? 1, 2, shall I change color? Okay, 1, 2, epsilon, okay, or let me write like this, like the book, epsilon. What else? 6, like euro, 6 epsilon, okay. Why am I so bad? Six epsilon, okay, minus 7 divided by epsilon, okay, and 42 epsilon, okay, minus 49 minus 6 epsilon square divided by 12 epsilon, okay, minus 14, and the last element is just 3. Okay, now this epsilon, okay, this epsilon could be a very small but positive number, maybe 0.01, 0.02, or let us say it is, let us exaggerate it and make it 0.1, but positive. The sign of 1 is positive, positive. Epsilon is, you know, assumed to be positive, okay, positive. So 6 epsilon, a small positive number, minus 7 divided by a small positive number, it'll make negative. If it is, for example, 0.1, 0.6 minus 7 is, I don't know, minus 6.4 divided by 0.1 makes, I don't know, minus 70 something. So it is minus. And the next one, come and check, is a small positive number, a small positive number, but this is very large. So a negative comes from the numerator, and this is a small positive number minus a big number, another negative. Negative divided by negative is positive. So now we can decide if the system is stable or not. Okay. We are ready to check, right? Number of sign changes. Positive, but from positive to negative. One. From negative to positive. Another sign changes. One. Okay. None left. Three is positive anyway. So there is nothing here. So one. There are two sign changes. That means two right half plane poles. Okay. We got two right half plane poles and the system is unstable. Okay. And the system is unstable. You can also give a very small, you know, tiny value with a negative sign. You will see that the first one, positive. The epsilon, you know, is assumed to be negative. And look at here, some negative, minus 7 is negative, divided by negative, positive. And come here, negative over negative is positive, and the sine of 3 is positive. The same result is obtained, plus, from plus to minus one change, and from minus to plus another change. So the same result, two right half plane poles, and the system is unstable. There's a, can't we stop at the first sign change and determine that there is at least one value in the right half, therefore the system is unstable. You can, well, okay, you can. But suppose that you are wondering the number of poles in the right half plane. Okay, even if there is one sign change, the system is unstable. You are right. Okay. It is almost 11. Let us take a 10 minutes break. Okay. 10 minutes or 12 minutes, whatever. We got some more material. Let us make it 10 minutes, okay? So, no other questions? If there's no questions, we can take a break. In the next hour, we will study the second special case. Okay, I'll stop sharing. I'll pause record. Okay, let's start where we just stopped. This is the special number, special case number two. Entire row is zero. If the whole row consists of zeros, okay? If this is the case, this indicates something. You are not recording. No, I am recording. Come on. I am recording. Okay, no problem. Look, it is flashing. Okay. Now this is weak. I don't know what. I'm now recording just from the start. Okay. It is. Okay, let's carry on. So if this is the case, okay, entire row, if the entire row is zero, this indicates something. This indicates that there is an even polynomial. That is a factor of the original polynomial. So what? You can say so what? Look at here. So if this is the case, that means you can exactly show that the whole equation, I'm not writing, can be factored, and one of those factors is purely even polynomial. What does that mean? It consists of only the even powers of S. Okay. So what happens if this is the case? If this is the case, the roots of this even polynomial, okay, the roots of even polynomial exhibit a symmetry of three kinds. Okay, even polynomials only have roots that are symmetrical about the origin. Okay, they are certainly symmetrical about the origin, but symmetrical about the origin can be seen in one, two, three ways. What are they? The roots can be symmetrical and real. Case A, they are symmetrical with respect to the imaginary axis, okay? According to imaginary axis, they can be symmetrical. This is number one. And they can be imaginary and they can be symmetrical about the real axis, okay, BB. Or they can be quadrantal. C, 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 C. That, what does that mean? That means they can be if they are four, they are complex conjugate and they can appear like this. They are quadrantal, they are still symmetrical. They are all symmetrical about the origin. One of them, the first one is real and symmetrical about the real, symmetrical and imaginary, or roots are quadrantal, okay? So you have to treat this case little bit with a more care, okay? Suppose this example, I'll solve another example from scratch. Let us see this. I don't wanna waste time. Look at this. This is the closed loop transfer function, 10 over s to the power of 5. 4, 3, 2, 1, 0 plus. So it could be, stable and or unstable. So we have to examine. So this is the label column starting from the maximum power, ends at the minimum power, which is 0. And what is the coefficient of s to the power of 5? It is 1, 1, 6. We are skipping one, you see, we are skipping the even ones. 8, 1, 6, 8. And the next, the skipped ones, 7, 42, 56, okay? 7, 42, 56. But we know that for the sake of simplification, we can multiply each element of this row by 1/7. 7 times 1/7, 1. 42 times 1/7, 6. 56 times 1/7, 8. You see the same two rows, 1, 6, 8, 1, 6, 8. Obviously, you will get 0, 0, 0. How do we know that? If they are the same, they will definitely produce zeros. 6, 1 times 6, -6, 0. 1 times 8, -8, 0. So 0, 0, 0. If this is the case, what are you gonna do? If this is the case, we solve that this row is filled with zeros. Zero, zero, zero. Okay, so we need to write an auxiliary polynomial. Auxiliary polynomial. What is auxiliary polynomial? A secondary polynomial, let's say. P of s. You need to write an auxiliary polynomial. P of s. And you need to go one line up, one row up, and write an even polynomial. Okay? Look at here. S to power of 1. So s to power of 4. I mean, s to power of 4, but the coefficient is 1. Then, what else? S to power of, after the simplification, 6. 6 times s to power of 2, even polynomial. Then 8. Okay? So, you're going to write this auxiliary polynomial by just going one up, okay? One level up, one row up, and write this even polynomial starting from this s to power of 4. Then s to power of has the coefficient of 1, okay? Then s square has the coefficient of 6. Then s to power of 0 has the coefficient of 8. And since this is equation 0, and then take the derivative of, okay, this auxiliary polynomial with respect to its variable s, okay, what you get from this derivation, 4 times 4 to 4 times s cube plus 12s, okay, plus 0. Okay, so get rid of these zeros and write, now this is a new polynomial. It's an odd polynomial where we just stopped, where the special case occurred, okay? So replace these zeros with these new coefficients of 4 and 12. 4, 12, and none, zero. And for 12, you multiply each component by 1 over 4. So 4 becomes 1, 12 becomes 3, and then carry on. And then carry on. How do we carry on? 3 by 3, 9, minus 8, 1, 1 over 3. Okay. 3 by 0, minus 0, divided by 3, 0. And then 8. 8 comes here. Why? Because 1 over 3 times 8 divided by 1 over 3. The none comes from here. You get 8. And then check this first column if there is any sign change. There is no sign change. Plus, 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 plus. So you say that no, there is no right half plane pole. Okay? So the system is perfectly stable, okay? Good? Okay, let us do this example. Okay. Oh my God, such a long example. What to do? But I need to point out something here. Let me... let us save time. Okay, let me just sort of read through this example. I'll do a simpler one, okay? Because, you know, this is eighth order. Come on, eighth order. When are we gonna deal with eighth order systems? Just for the sake of example. Look at here, 20 over 8 to power of, s to power of 8, s to power of 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. It is, no, it could be stable or unstable, we don't know, because it has all the powers of s, the coefficients are all positive. It looks like a stable system, but we need to check by means of Rouse-Hurwitz criteria. Okay, so from s to power of 8 to s to power of 0. And look at the coefficients. We'll take this 1. Okay. Okay, this is, some people may think that it is 7. Okay. This, so 1, 12, I'm skipping 1, 39, 48, 20. Okay. That means I'm taking the even powers of S, coefficients of even powers of S. Okay, 1, 1, 12, 39, 48, 20. And the rest of the coefficients. 1, 22, 59, 38. 1, 22, 59, 38. And since there's something here, 0. Okay, then do these computations. 12 minus 22 makes minus 10. Okay. 39 minus 59 makes minus 20. 48 minus 38 makes 10, plus 10, yes. And what else? 20, okay. So minus 10, minus 20, 10, 20, they are all multiple of 10s. So get rid of all these zeros, okay. You get minus 1, minus 2, 1, and 2. And carry on. Okay. Suppose that we carried on, okay. Oh, let me show you the problematic. And once we arrived here, and we saw that, we will see that 0, 0, okay, 0, 0, 0. So the entire, this is the special case number 2. Entire row is 0. What are we going to do? We're going to write a auxiliary, an auxiliary polynomial, a secondary polynomial. How can we do that? Go one up, okay, and write this polynomial of P of S. What is it? P of S. S to power of 4 plus 3 S square. 1, 3, 2 S to power of 0. Okay. That means 2. Then derivative of this. Okay. P dot. Let's make it easy. P dot 4 times S cube plus 6S plus 0. None. And plug those coefficients into here where the, you name it, the row of it is called, some books write this, row of zeros. So the coefficients are gonna be 4, 6, okay, this is rows, 4, 6, 0, 0, 0, 4, 6, okay, divide by 2, 4 becomes 2, 6 becomes 3, and then carry on. Okay, and then carry on. Now it is time to check or to study this first column. Okay, you can say that, come on hocam, why do we continue, you know, plus, plus, and negative, the system is unstable. Why you bother, you know, you just stop. You may be right, but how about if we are wondering the number of poles in the left, number of poles in the right, number of poles on the J omega axis, so that we can deal with those so-called unstable poles and pull them to the left to make the system stable. So it would be wise to see the number of poles in the right half plane, so that in the design stage we can try to pull them to the left to make the system stable. Okay. You need to do a kind of table, okay? Because we have to study the even polynomial separately, because we know that the roots of the even polynomial exhibit symmetry about the origin, either real and symmetrical, or imaginary and symmetrical, or quadrantal, okay? And even polynomial, and oh, this is a proof, sir. Let me say that I'm teaching. I need half an hour. Please wait. Okay, good. So we are studying the eighth order polynomial with two pieces, okay? Even part and the rest. So even part, which is fourth order, okay, fourth order, and the rest, or other, another fourth order. Why? Because the total is eight, okay? Four, another four makes total eighth order. So let us start, and then we are doing this table. So right half plane, RHP, RHP, left half plane, and imaginary axis, poles. Now come here. Start from the even polynomial. When we start from the even polynomial, look at here, positive, 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 positive. So no sign changes. That means, what does that mean? There is number of sign changes equals number of right half plane, right? So if it is none, that means there is no right half plane pole. Okay, so right half plane pole is zero, okay? And we have to immediately think of the symmetry, okay? Since there is none in the right half plane, that means there is none in the left half plane, okay? Zero, and the left half plane poles are zero, okay? So where are those four poles? Obviously, they are on the J omega axis, okay? And then study the upper part, the rest of the polynomial, plus, plus, minus, plus. So that means from plus to minus one, from minus to plus another one, that means two right half plane poles. Right half plane poles, two right half plane poles. How about the other two? They cannot be on the J omega axis, not at all. It is not possible. Only even polynomial may produce poles on the J omega axis. So just give zero. So that means the two are in the left half plane. So in total, zero plus two makes two, zero plus two makes two, four plus zero makes four. So there are two in the right half plane, two in the left half plane, four on the J omega axis. So it is something like this. Two in here, and four on the J omega axis. Is it stable or unstable? Of course it is unstable. The system is unstable. We say unstable, okay? as an adjective, unstable, or if you wanna you know, convert it to make it name, we say instability. Instability. We don't say instability. We say either unstable or there's an instability here. Instability. Okay. So this is unstable. So there is an instability here. Okay. From Anas. What is that? What is it written in Arabic here? Mistake. Okay. Because there is no meaning. I see. A wrong keyboard. It happens to me as well. You wouldn't believe I used to take even Persian course on Persian language, and I'm familiar with Arabic language. I am quite familiar with Spanish, so I love those. How did we understand that the number of poles in the left half plane and imaginary axis? Okay, let me do a summary. We are checking two components individually. Okay, two components individually: the even polynomial and the rest. Start from even polynomial. If you go this way, we see that there is no sign changes. So that means there is no right half plane pole. Okay, so give a zero right half plane pole for even polynomial. And due to symmetry, okay, we know that they have to be symmetrical, those poles of even polynomial. They cannot be on the j omega axis. I mean, oops, where are we? They cannot be, if the right is zero, left must be also zero. So zero, zero. So where are they? That means they are on the imaginary axis. Come here. We saw that there are from plus to zero, zero to plus, from plus to minus, minus to plus. That means two right half plane poles, two right half plane. Okay. This is not because of symmetry. There are two, and we know that they cannot be there on the j omega axis. So where are they? They are left, and then we are just add them up: 0, 2, 2, 0, plus 2, 2, 4, plus 0, 4. How did we? Is it clear now, Miss? I think maybe I'll leave these two examples to you. Okay. Now let us see this example. Okay, let us see this example. Very similar to the one you know, we talked on in the beginning of the course. It was 3 over s plus 1, s plus 2, 7 over s plus 1, s plus 2. And one of them was, the first one was stable, the second one was unstable, if you remember. Now it is time to determine the range of stability, the range of stability. So find the range of gain. Okay, this is the problem. The problem states that find the range of gain k for the system given that will cause the system to be stable, to be unstable, and marginally stable. Assume that you are working with positive values of gain. Okay, so let us check the system and see the stability range. Okay, so we have to first find the closed loop transfer function. Okay, closed loop transfer function, T of S. You just simply open up this, S square will be S cube plus 7s plus 11s, 18s, 18s square plus 77s plus k. Okay, so this is the characteristic equation. Okay, and start from s cube, s cube, s square, s to the power of 1, 0. Okay, the coefficient of s cube is 1. The other odd one is 77. Okay, odd power of s, 3, 1. And then the rest, 18k. 18k. 18 times 77, well, makes 1386 minus k divided by 18. And then k comes from, why? Because this is zero. From here, nothing comes. Multiply this by k, divide by this. You end up with k. Okay, now study this column. Okay. If this column is just, you know, having positive signs, that means the system is stable. So the stability range, we know that k is greater than zero. Okay, we know we can, so naturally we can know that we are working with positive k's or negative k's. So plus what values of k makes this plus values smaller than 1386. Okay, and this, and it has to be greater than zero, so this is positive. So the stability range for k, the stability range for gain, okay, for positive gain is this, zero, 1386. So if we are sure that, okay, if we can make sure that k is within this range, the system definitely produces stable responses. Okay. So stable for the system is stable for this range. Okay. The system is unstable for k greater than 1386. Okay. And we will see that. How about if k is 1386? What happens? What happens? Okay, you can say, well, what happens if k is zero? If k is zero, that means your closed loop system is not closed. It is open loop. So, shall we do that? So suppose that we are analyzing this case, okay? For k equals 1386. That means this is zero. This is also zero. So yes, it'll be marginally stable. You are right. But I want to show that on two of them are the imaginary axis. Okay. And the rest, if they are on the right, okay, it is still unstable. But two, if the maximum number is two on the j omega axis and the rest is on the left, the system is, as you said, margin is stable. Okay, so we introduced 1386 for k, and we obtained a rows, okay, rows, and a row filled with zeros. So what to do? We need to get rid of these zeros. So what are we doing, as you remember? Going one line up, one level up, one row up, and writing an auxiliary polynomial. Okay. Let me change color. Okay. Okay, P of S will be what? You name it. 18 S square. Okay. 18 S square plus K. K is what? This. 1386. Okay. Get its derivative with respect to S. Okay. You get 36 S. And introduce here 36. This is 1386. Okay. Now plus plus plus. But still, we need to analyze as a table. Did I create a table? I did not. Let us create a table. Okay. Let me summarize here. When, okay, k is 1386. What happens? The first column starts from s to power of 2, 1, 0, and I'll take it from here. 118, 36, okay. 1, 18, 36, and this. Okay, now number of poles in the right half plane, number of poles in the left half plane, number of poles on the j omega axis. First, the even polynomial, even poly. Okay. And the other, or I say the rest of the polynomial, rest of the polynomial, and total. Okay. Now, not a table. Even polynomial, what is the order of even polynomial? 2, if you remember, we wrote a polynomial of s square. So s square, and it is third order. So that means the rest of the polynomial, so this is second order. Rest of the polynomial will be first order. Total is third order, okay? So looking at here, there is no sign change. Plus, 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 plus. So that means there is no pole in the right half plane. Because of the symmetry, if this is zero, this must be zero because they have to be symmetrical. So where are they? That means they are on the j omega axis. How many of them? They are in total two. So two of them are on the imaginary axis. And rest of the polynomial, there is only one number and it is positive. So there is no zero right half plane pole. And because it is not a even polynomial, there is no on the j omega axis. So where could it be? It is in the left half plane. So the total 0 plus 0, 0, 0 plus 1, 1, 2 plus 0, 2. So the distribution of the poles will look like this. Okay. Two of them are on the j omega axis, okay? One of them is here, and the response is, what's the marginally stable. Marginally stable. So the response will be alternating between margins. It'll be something like this. Actually, this is not correct. Well, it is correct and not. It'll be something like this. Okay, this is time axis. Okay, suppose that this is your input step function, but the response will change between 0 and 2.
Okay.
So this is a typical marginally stable system. Okay. As a matter of fact, this analysis tells us something else. Very interesting. Well, I find it interesting anyway. We can even know the period, okay, the period or frequency of this sustained, so-called sustained or continuous oscillation. How can we know? Come here, come to this auxiliary polynomial. Where is it? Auxiliary polynomial. Here it is. The roots of auxiliary polynomial gives us the frequency of oscillation in radian per second. So 18 S squared plus 1386 equals, okay, zero. S is plus and minus 1386 divided by 8 is a negative number. So it will be definitely imaginary, okay? Why don't we run and do some simulations, okay? Okay, we got time for that. I'll be quick. So let me define S. Okay. And let us give K first. I don't know. What is the range? 0 to 1,000. I don't know, 500, for example. Okay. And the transfer function was K over S plus, not that, 7 and 11. S plus 7, okay. S plus 7, S plus 11. Okay, this is our G. Actually, you can see this in a better way, just zero pole gain formats, okay. And this is our G, okay, 500 over S times S plus 11, S plus 7. And our closed-loop transfer function is going to be 5 feedback, okay, G1, because it's unit feedback. And this is our T. And you will see that we will have you can check the poles, okay, pole of T, okay. You will see that they will be definitely all negative, all in the left half plane. You see, negative. One is real at minus 15. The other two are minus 1.45, plus and minus 5.5 J, okay, or I. And if you plot step T, okay, you will see a nicely damped sign, okay? So it is stable. Okay, let us increase K. Let us make K exactly. No, let us make it 2000. 2000. You will see that it will be unstable. Okay. Even we don't have to make it that big. 1500. Okay, 1500. G will be this, okay, and T will be this. If you check the, look at, no need to check This is negative. This has a negative. This is plus, minus, plus. That means at least one pole in the right half plane. So this system is definitely unstable. Let us see the step response. Look at this. Let us plot it up to some, I don't know, seconds, five. Look at here. Within 5 seconds, it grows that much. So if you go further, you will see that it goes to infinity. It grows unboundedly. Nothing can stand this. So it is unstable. Now let us introduce this limit. Okay, what was it? 1, 3, 8, 6, right? And this is G, and this is T. Okay. T is, yes, this is T. Now check out, no need to check. Look at the roots. One of them is on the left, the other one is on the j omega axis, plus and minus square root 77. Okay. And if you plot this step T, okay, up to some seconds, I don't know, 5 again, you will see a very nice sign. You see? Very nice sign. Look at here. And I say that we can determine the period or frequency of this. Go back to this. Where is the roots of even polynomial? The roots of even polynomial is here. Square root 1386 divided by 18. Actually, I saw it. Look at here. 1 square S12, okay, is plus and minus square root 1386 divided by 18. I think this is 17, and square root of 17. How do I know? I know, no, not 70, 77. But look, I think this is 77. Yes. So the period, the frequency is 8.77. So the omega is 8.77 radian per second. And the period is gonna be, as you see, omega is 2 pi over t. T is 2 pi over omega, which gives us, so this is S12 is omega, in fact. T is, period is 2 times pi divided by S12, which gives us this much seconds, 0.7 seconds. Let's check it out. Look at this. From one peak to the next is around that much. Look at here. You can see from here, from 1.5 to 0.5, 0.7 seconds. Okay. So, well, that's it really. As you see, Rao's orbits stability criterion is good. Rao table, making use of Rao table, will tell us the distribution of the closed loop poles. How many right half plane poles? How many left half plane poles? How many poles on the j omega axis? If this is, and we can determine the stability range, okay? And also we can find the gain that makes the system marginally stable, and if the system works at this gain, if it is marginally stable, we can even find out the period or frequency of, if you do this, F equals 1 over T, that means the frequency of this oscillation is 1.4 hertz, right? Okay, is there any question? I think it was a nice, I personally like this today's session. I hope you find it useful. And please, I think a question is coming. No, this is my mistyping. Any question? Hocam, I wish I could discuss these things because I'm sure you would, you know, give me lots of inspirations because there's a nice math underneath. Okay, so it is just noon time, 12:00. Let us stop and carry on. I was dreaming to start a new chapter today. I mean, this is a new chapter. Start another new one. But what's the point? The point is, you know, delivering the course, you know, as effective as possible. So I hope you find it clear and understandable, easily understandable. Okay, I'll stop then, since there is no question. Thank you very much for joining the course. Look at here, this happens everywhere. After the midterm, only just a bunch of, you know, 11 students. Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Let us talk about it then later on. Absolutely. The polls, the closed loop polls actually are the eigenvalues under normal conditions. Yes, definitely. All right, then. Have a great day.